Welcome to Studio One at Metronome in Nottingham. I'm Dean Jackson. It's great to find you here for one of the highlights of this week. I know I'm just seeing the comments coming in already. This guy is literally my hero, is a phrase that I've just seen come up on the screen there. I'm not even going to attempt to summarise a CV. I'm just going to dive straight in and say, Steve Albini, good to have you here.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you for being there, wherever you are. So where are you?
I'm in the control room of Studio A at Electrical Audio in Chicago.
And this is your studio, right?
Yep.
We're going to have a little we've got a little guided tour video to look at that around there a little bit later on. Steve, do you have a preferred way of being described other than just a general music legend?
Well, legend makes me a little uncomfortable. Most legends are kind of are dead and false. So what other people call me isn't really of that much interest to me. I describe myself as a sound recording engineer, and I'm in a band, so I guess I qualify as a musician, although I don't feel like a musician in the traditional sense. But I've been in a band for a very long time, so I guess I can't dodge that one.
How do you mean you don't feel like a musician in a traditional sense? What does
that mean? I feel like I'm like the music that I make and the scene that I'm a part of and the underground that I've been sort of resident in for my whole tenure as a musician hasn't really been principally concerned with music, but has been principally concerned with the greater culture and is more of a political and social identity than it is an occupational one.
One of the things that sets you apart from all of the people that do a job like yours is the fact that when you work with bands and you're sound engineering their album, we can use the word production, I know it's not...
Sure, that's fine.
When you're doing that role, you don't insist, in fact, you shun completely away from the idea of having points on that album. In other words, almost commission, for want of a better description, as that album sells over weeks, months and years.
Yeah, I mean, that's a personal thing. Like there was a convention developed over time as a means of people in the music business extracting more and more money from the bands that were responsible for generating all the money. Like the first mechanism was to pay the bands a very paltry portion of the income of the record as a royalty. And then when that didn't feel greedy enough, they started figuring out ways to claw back some of that royalty for themselves. And that's what producers' points are. They're a means of taking money away from the band that's put the record out and giving it to other people in the music industry on a sort of a percentage basis. And it's just, I think it's an unethical practice and I just don't want to participate in it. I'm perfectly happy coming to an agreement with somebody about how much my time is worth, and then I get paid for my time and we're done. I mean, that's a completely normal way of working with just about every other industry. It's only in the music business where this odd perversion of me taking some of your income for life has become normalized. I think it's indefensible ethically, and I just won't do it.
And yet I've been looking around to see if I can find anybody else that stands beside you in this policy, and I can't find other people, you know, so you are unique in this regard as far as I can see.
Yeah, well, I mean, people don't often look to avoid maximizing their income. And if I were to take royalties on the records that I work on, I would earn more money, but it would also make me feel awful about what I had done to the people I was working for, you know. I mean, I'm trying to figure out why this is. I'm just going to unplug this phone. Okay. I apologize.
No worries.
Yeah, literally every penny that I would get paid in royalties would mean that was a penny that wasn't going to the person whose music was being sold. And I would feel terrible about that. And peace of mind is worth something to me. And apparently it's worth that much, you know.
It's interesting because I've interviewed over the years many of the artists who've worked with you, and they've all to a one spoken extremely highly of you and the way that you work with them. Actually, what do you think is the property that you've got, the quality that you've got I'll use the word producer again, that makes people hold you in such high regard?
I try to deliver on the basic promise, which is that the kind of record you're trying to make, I'm going to do my best to help you make it. Like that's basically it. I don't have an agenda when I come into the studio with a band. My agenda is to satisfy the band and their ambition. Bearing in mind that a lot of people working in the studio have had the record that they're about to make, they've had that record developing in their minds for months or years, and they have a whole set of ambitions and expectations that they want to realize for this music. And some of it is ethereal, but some of it is very practical. Like I want to be able to perform in this way. I want to have the band be able to perform in a certain way in the studio. And we've never been allowed to do that because of the restrictions of studio work. So if we can do it this way, then that will be a goal realized or whatever. And so a large part of my job is just listening to what the people that I'm working with want to do and then figuring out a way to technically execute it. I'll give you a couple of examples. I've done quite a few records with a singer named Nina Nastasia from, she lives in New York, and she typically will assemble an ad hoc band to play with her on her records. She doesn't have a regular touring band. She just has people that she's, you know, associates that she works with. And for each session, she assembles a group of musicians. And that group can be anywhere from two or three people to, in the most extreme cases, 12 or 13 people that she's playing with. And her conception of her music is such that she needs to be singing and playing with all of these people around her, so that they can interact as an ensemble, so that they can perform as a group with her sort of leading the action. It's not satisfying for her to hear music and then sing over it. That's just not a way that she conceives of her music, and she doesn't find that rewarding. So literally every song that I've ever recorded for her, she has been in the company of her band or of her musicians singing and playing as though it were a live show. Now, other things are done after that. There are some overdubs done instrumentally. There's some production effects brought to bear, that sort of thing. But just that basic thing of her being able to be surrounded by all of her friends that she's been rehearsing this music with and being able to perform live, that's not the norm in studio practice. In studio practice, typically, the norm would be to assemble the music and then have a singing performance superimposed on top of it. In this way, she, as the singer, as the vocalist, she's kind of conducting the entire group. And like I said, it can be a pretty unwieldy group of as many as a dozen or more people. If she, you know, that's how she wants to conduct herself in the studio. And if when she had come here, my first reaction to that was, oh, no, we're not going to do it that way. We're going to do it my way. Then I would be creating a sort of an obstacle to her realizing this ambition of hers. And so I try very hard not to say no. I try very hard to take what somebody wants to do when they walk in the door and execute it. Another thing, I think my sympathies being with the musicians, with the band, is a kind of a natural outgrowth of me having been in bands my whole life. Whereas some people who work in the professional side of the studio business, like some engineers and producers, they came at it from a sort of an administrative angle, like they worked their way up through the ranks within a company, or they, you know, never having been performing musicians, they were sort of imposed into the studio environment as a technical authority or as a production authority. And so their sympathies are for the administrative hierarchy, and their background and their thinking is all part of this sort of, you know, administrative structure that thankfully with the way that the music business has changed, that kind of thinking is kind of dying out. But that used to be a norm for producers and engineers, is that they were comfortable working within a corporate structure and answering up the corporate chain of command. And so when they had to talk to a musician about, I can't see the drummer well enough, or, things of little sort of musician level concerns, like those were alien to them, whereas those are natural and normal for me. And so I intuitively grasp those kinds of problems, and I'm more sympathetic,
We hear of some artists, when they go to work with particular producers, ending up having big arguments with them because the producer wants to take the record in a different direction to the band, or wants to treat the vocals differently, or to do the mix differently to the band. Do you ever get, what happens if one of the musicians that you work with says, Steve, what do you think we should do about this? Do you just return it and say, well, what do you want to do?
Well, normally, a big part of the job is listening to what their ambitions are, and if they're at a conundrum and they don't know what to do in a certain situation, I'll explain a number of options. And from that point, some of those options may intrigue them, and they'll want to experiment with them and hear those options. It's extremely rare for me to say, what we should do right here? We should, it's rare, because I don't have that kind of confidence in my own aesthetic. And also I think there's a kind of a stunted egotism involved with some producers, where they want to be associated with music. They want to have a kind of an authorial relationship with music, but they don't want to bother actually making music, like putting a band together, and it just seems like way too much work. So they insinuate themselves into the relationship that a band has with its music, or that a musician or a singer will have with their music. And in that way, they sort of wrest some control of it. They claim some of the authorship of it. And I just don't have that impulse. I have my own band. If I want to make a ridiculous fucking record with all of my stupid ideas on it, I can do that. Like, I've done that. I've been in a band that has done stupid things. And it's very satisfying to do that as an indulgence for your own band. But it would just be rude and mean for me to do that to somebody else's record,
It's so refreshing to hear all of this. What was the journey, Steve, that took you from being in your first band to sitting in the studio that you're in now, with lots of other musicians coming in to make records with you?
As a teenager, I sort of got excited about music during the punk rock era. And, my friends and I were sort of manic about music at the same time. So we started playing together and we formed a band. And then I grew up in a small town in Montana called Missoula, Montana. And I left after high school to come to Chicago to go to college. And in the back of my mind, I thought, well, I'm going there to go to college, but there's got to be a punk scene in Chicago. And that was sort of a major motivation for me to come here, was that it would be a big city and then I would get to see live music and I would get to meet, I would get to be involved in a music scene. And that happened. Like, I came here, there was a very vibrant underground music scene, and I kind of insinuated myself into it. And then I started making music with those people, and I started to, my circle of friends and my peer group was all other underground musicians in Chicago. And at the time, doing a recording of your band was a very expensive and stressful enterprise. Like, to go into a professional studio was just out of the question, because it was too expensive. And just to give you the scale of the expense, a studio like the one I'm in now, to make a proper recording in a studio like this, would have cost on the order of $1,000 or $1,500 a day. And to calibrate that in terms of the cost of money back then, you could buy a new Mustang convertible sports car for $5,000.
Wow.
So I guess in today's money, if a car like that is going to cost you 50 grand, then a day in the studio equivalent would be 10 grand or something like that. So it was just an extraordinary expense that no band would ever contemplate doing. So almost all recording for underground bands and non-professional environment was this sort of haphazard DIY recording. And I developed a set of techniques that allowed me to get recordings done in that, with that frame of mind, quickly and efficiently. And then that made me useful within the music scene. You know, when you're in a band, you want to make recordings of your band so you have some evidence of what you've done. And then all of your friends are in bands and they want to make recordings of their bands. And so I ended up making recordings of a lot of my friends' bands. And then gradually that transitioned into me going into the studio, into a proper studio with those bands to do recordings there. And then over time, that peer group, that circle of friends, became a client base of people who were willing to pay me money to work as an engineer. And 9 or 10 years down the pike from there, I had enough work that I could quit my job after college and then just be a full-time engineer. And I did that enough that I could say that I saved up enough money that I could then buy a building and build a studio in it. And that's where I've been ever since. Wow. The arc of that, like from the first moment that I said to my friends, hey, let's get a tape recorder and record ourselves. And that would have been like 1979, 78, somewhere in there, until the point where I was able to quit my job and be a full-time engineer. Like that was a span of 10 years or so. Mm. So it's not the case that I like decided to do this and then a few years later that was my profession. It took a very long time, and it was a long learning process and also a long socializing process, because and in the beginning I was just fucking around with no consequences, doing things on my own. And then at the end of that arc, you know, I'm working for other people who have expectations and demands of me, and my, you know, the consequences for failure actually were significant.
Can we just rewind, have a look at some of Big Black to look back at the early days?
Sure.
Let's quick look at that now.
What a liar. Don't be fine now.
What do you think of when you see that clip?
It's like looking at any picture of or image of yourself from a long time ago. You're sort of momentarily, you're surprised that that's actually you. And then it starts to sort of repopulate your memory with what it was like to be there and do that.
And which musicians were impacting on your sound at that stage, do you think, your influences?
When I was forming Big Black, the aesthetic that I was pursuing was kind of an offshoot of the original punk rock idea. There were bands that were contemporaneous with punk rock that were not stylistically hidebound to, guitar bass drums, you know, Chuck Berry based rock and roll sort of. And those were the bands that were the most inspirational to me, the bands that were kind of left field of that, but contemporaneous. Bands like Suicide and Kraftwerk, Tuxedo Moon. There was a French band called Metal Urbane that I really liked. There was an English band called Cabaret Voltaire, whose early electronic stuff was really driving and really stimulating to me. That was, you know, the stuff that I was stealing from to put my aesthetic together. But then socially, I was, you know, embedded in this underground scene in Chicago, which was very fraternal and very collaborative. And so I was very influenced by my peers in the Chicago underground music scene, bands like Naked Ray Gun and the Effigies. And they were very much part of the do-it-yourself punk underground. Like, you know, you would organize your own shows. You would take care of all the details of your band's business. Essentially, none of those bands had managers or agents or anything like that. Everybody was doing everything for themselves. And that really informed my behavior then, and it still informs my behavior now. Like, I learned how to conduct myself by being a part of that scene and seeing how you needed to operate with efficiency, and you needed to, like, be conscious of the fact that a lot of institutional things were set up not for your benefit, but were set up as kind of exploitative avenues. And that whole process was, I mean, that's sort of how I formed my personality, was by learning how to navigate that world.
So what sort of things were exploitative? Was, for example, was pay to play in existence in that era?
In the underground, no. But right. In the mainstream music business, yes. So all of the underground bands basically just abdicated any interest in being part of the mainstream music business. Like, if you had to pay people to get your records on the radio, well, we're not doing that, so I guess we're not going to get played on the radio. Let's just do other things instead, you know? Or if these bigger venues are not going to allow bands like us to play, that doesn't matter. We'll find other places to play. We'll do, you know, we'll play in lofts or in basements, or, you know, we'll find immigrant bars that have a dead night, and we'll put shows on in those bars. And, you know, there was a big synthesis in Chicago, at least. There was a big sort of a synthesis between the gay subculture and gay underground and the punk subculture and punk underground. Like, there were a lot of clubs were shared in common. A lot of the personalities on both scenes were sort of like leading lights of both scenes. And there was a kind of a kindred spirit of people working under the notice of the mainstream, but within a broad circle, broad community, and a broad and diverse community within the city. Like, we all knew about each other. Like, you'd go to a show and there'd be the same 200 people that were at the show that you went to the previous week, and there'd be a kid handing out flyers for a show that you were going to go to next week, right? But you would never see a notice of any of these in the weekly newspaper, and there would be no, you know, advertising for it. And you couldn't buy a ticket to it. You would just have to be part of that community. And I felt very buoyed and very supported and very much a part of a continuum and as a part of a spectrum of people who were all working to advance this underground culture without making any concessions to the norms of business or the norms of society or whatever. Like, we were just going to carry on. We were going to do our thing. And if the rest of the world ignored us, that was totally fine, because we were self-sufficient.
It's a great attitude to have, and I think it's, well, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's an attitude I think that will be associated with being quite young. Do you think as you get older that attitude dwindles a little?
I noticed that there was a big distinction between American underground bands, who are sort of a type in this manner, you know, in this sort of do-it-yourself fashion, and then bands in other countries. When I first started traveling internationally in the 80s, it seemed like the distinction between the mainstream music business and culture and the underground wasn't as distinct. Like, you know, bands like punk bands were in the top 10 in England, for yeah. example, and that was just unthinkable in the US. So that mentality was completely commonplace in our peer group in the US, and completely alien to the thinking of people elsewhere, who all thought that they had a shot at some kind of formal success. Like, making a career in music was never on anybody's mind at that period.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because in Britain, punk grew from the kind of people being tired of the Bee Gees, Saturday Night Fever, Grease kind of thing. I wonder why that backlash happened in Britain but not in the States.
I mean, there was a kind of an anti-disco backlash in the States, but a lot of that was sort of retrograde thinking. You know, some of it was racist, some of it was homophobic. You know, I wasn't part of the club culture, and I found that the club scene kind of repellent, but I recognized the sort of thrill of identity that people who were involved in that had. And so I was, you know, while aesthetically that music didn't appeal to me and that culture didn't appeal to me, I didn't have any of the kind of disdain for it that a lot of other people did. Like those people were my friends. Those people were part of our scene, you know.
Which is interesting, isn't it? Oh, sorry. Did you want to carry on?
Well, no, I feel like there was a, like the earliest iterations of punk music were basically just a kind of irreverent and very stripped down rock and roll. But that sort of lit the fuse on an idea, which was you could do any kind of music. You didn't need to conform to these expectations of show business, right? And that's the thing that animated me, is this idea that everything was fair game. Not that it was, you know, a particular group of people or a particular culture. The idea was that it could be anybody, it could be anything. And you would, and going to these early punk shows in Chicago in the, like say 1980, for example, when I first got to town, you would see every kind of weirdo. You know, you'd see elements of the criminal underground, the drug subculture, like political wackos, you know, anarchists and communists and intellectuals. Like I said, there was a big crossover with the gay community. You'd see homeless or street people. You'd see like hustlers and immigrants. And it was just like the weirdest fucking people, people who had no comfortable place in regular society. But you couldn't, there wasn't a thread of continuity between them. It was just all of the weirdos went to these underground events and identified as this subculture, which then, you know, sort of progressed aesthetically. And that's what excited me, was that I was seeing all these different kinds of people, and every single one of them seemed to be valid at that point. Like they didn't feel marginalized when they were there, you know.
So by now, you're starting to work with other bands, other artists on their productions. Did what you've described as a very broad range of friendship groups, of contacts. So did that mean that the music you were working on in those early days could be multi-genre?
Idiomatically, it was a lot of different kinds of sounds, but culturally, it was all, generally, it was underground music, like, you know, professional bands would go to a professional studio, or bands that had backing would be somehow, you know, would be backed, and they could afford to go into a professional proper studio. It was, you know, the street level musicians that were my peer group and my friends, those are the people that I started working with professionally, as a, you know, for lack of a better term, professionally. It wasn't until I'd been doing that for the better part of 10 years that I started to get calls from people that I didn't already know, that people who weren't already friends of mine, to work on their records.
I can see where your ethical view came from in those early days, because if you were working with friends, you wouldn't want to rip them off, would you? And you carried that through to people that weren't necessarily your friends that were coming to you to produce records.
Yeah, I mean, I just recognize that we're all working on the same project. It's not that... this band is trying to make a career for themselves and I'm trying to make a career for myself on their back. It's that between us, we're part of this larger community of musicians and artists, and all of us are trying to advance the culture. We're all trying to make like a more interesting, more diverse, smarter kind of culture. And we're all working on the same project. So I'm not, and in so doing, if I were to try to maximize my extraction from that culture, from that working group, I would weaken it. So what I'm trying to do is be a collaborator. I'm trying to cooperate and be a collaborator and be a facilitator. I'm not trying to just extract what I can for myself out of that.
If I can make an observation here, and forgive me if I get this wrong, I hope it doesn't offend you, but this you strike me as somebody who doesn't have an ego in this. You're doing it without ego. So was there a point at which a band or artist appeared who made a call to come to your studio and you thought, oh my goodness, this is next level?
There are a few like sort of inflection points. I remember the first time I got a call from a band who were not friends of mine and who were not friends of mine, but who had tracked me down specifically, that seemed like an inflection point. Like, oh, that's different. That, I guess that means that I'm known to people other than my circle of friends or whatever. And then when I quit my job in 1988, when I quit my job for good, that seemed like an inflection point. Like, well, I guess this is my profession now. This is what I'm doing now.
And do you remember? Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. I don't really have that many. Like, I don't think of my tenure in music episodically. Really, it does genuinely seem like I'm doing the same thing every day. Like yesterday I did a session with a band that session is ongoing, but it had exactly the same feeling to me as if I had done that same session with that same band 25 years ago. I would have behaved the same way, they would have behaved the same way, and our relationship would have been the same and the results would have been similar. You know, I don't feel like there have been chapters in my tenure in music. I feel like it's been one long weekend, you know.
But what a weekend. You mentioned relationship in there, though. Are there some artists that you work with whom you develop a particular a fondness, as it were?
Oh, absolutely. Like, I would say that's probably the highlight of my job, is that by working with people in the studio, you get to know them and you get to know their aesthetic and you get to know what, you know, what motivates them and what animates them. And there are some incredible, you develop relationships with these people because they're amazing. You know, I mentioned Nina Nastasia, who's a dear friend of mine. I've made a half a dozen records with her. Early on in the early 90s, late 80s, early 90s, there was a circle of musicians in Chicago that was a very productive group of friends. And, you know, I did a bunch of records with a band called the Jesus Lizard, and they were good friends, and our relationship lasted for many years. And I've done quite a few records with a band from the Bay Area called Neurosis. There's a group of musicians from Louisville, Kentucky, who are all friends and associates, and I've worked on quite a few of their records. I have very warm feelings about a lot of the people that I work with, and our friendship has endured, and, you know, is kind of the main thing at this point. The fact that we've worked on, like, as an example, Kim Deal from the Pixies and the Breeders, is a dear friend, and I think of her principally as a dear friend. I have worked on many records with her, but I that almost seems incidental at this point.
It's really reassuring to hear, because very often it does feel, when we look at other studios, as though there's a conveyor belt, a production line, as it were. So the fact that you're forming these relationships is great. I was reading online an article earlier about your fondness for the Manic Street Preachers. I think you came over to Rockfield and worked with them in the UK
for a while, didn't you? I only worked on one record with them, but we got along well, and I thought they were interesting thinkers. And, at the time they were refreshing politically. There was a big sort of me element in the music scene to them. Like, all the Britpop bands and stuff were all sort of kind of revolting. And I liked how they had, echoes of a socialist upbringing and that sort of thing, which was nice. We got along personally, and I admired their work ethic, and I thought they did a great job.
So we get on to, I'm guessing, I may be wrong, but I'm guessing you asked about this more than anything else. So forgive me for this, but we're going to talk a bit about Nirvana here. I found an article, a letter that you wrote to Nirvana online earlier, which basically laid out how you would work with them during the recording of the album In Utero. And there were some amazing points. Well, firstly, is that a genuine letter? Is it? It's not.
Oh, let me explain. There, at the time I was asked to work on the Nirvana record, there had been rumors circulating for several months prior that I was meant to work on the next Nirvana record. The rumors themselves had become substantial enough that they were kind of a nuisance. Like, I was getting calls from journalists. It somewhat affected my reputation in that I was still working, you know, on a very small scale with independent and underground bands who couldn't be expected to afford a professional producer. And if in their mind I was now graduated into that league, then I was off limits, you know, then I would be unaffordable or unavailable. So it was actually causing some nuisance. And so I made a point of, I actually wrote a letter to one of the music papers in England who had been sort of promoting these rumors. And I said, listen, I don't know where your information is coming from, but no one has spoken to me about making this record. And shortly after that, I got a call from Kurt Cobain saying, hey, so you've heard these rumors that we were going to talk to you about doing this record. I figured I might as well call you. And so we had a long conversation about what it would, what working on a record would entail. And then at the end of that conversation, he said, all right, well, I'm going to tell the other guys in the band what we talked about. And I said, well, tell you what, why don't I just write it all up, basically the germane points of our conversation. I wrote them up in a letter, and then I sent that letter by fax, which was the pre-email standard of sending things by fax. So I sent that letter by fax to Kurt's house, and then he just brought that to the band so that they could see what the substance of our conversation was.
And basically, that
letter was not meant to be an introduction. It was meant to be a précis of the conversation that I'd had with Kurt about what working on a record would entail and what my motivations were and what my concerns were.
And amongst the points that you made there was that, you know, that this may attract a whole new layer of attention to you, the fact that you work with Nirvana, but actually that's of no consequence to you. You're not bothered about that, really.
Yeah, I mean, whenever you work with somebody famous, you end up having to deal with their fame to a degree as kind of, you know, reflected from them onto you, then you have to contend with it in some way. I've gotten better at that sort of thing. I've gotten more diplomatic at that sort of thing over time, just because I realize it's not, you know, I don't want to be an obstacle. I don't want to create problems for somebody else because my ego wouldn't allow me to get out of the way when somebody wanted to talk about them. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I've gotten better about that. At the time when people would come at me with their opinions about Nirvana, I would sometimes be, I would be shorter with them than I think was wise. And I think it was partly due to the novelty of the situation. I mean, they were the biggest band in the world.
Yeah.
And I was just some schmuck, you know?
Well.
So at the time it was like, you have the biggest band in the world and then they have this schmuck. Let's ask the schmuck's opinion. You know?
But I mean, they were the biggest band in the world, but, and they just made the biggest record for many years as well, and you were involved in making the follow-up. So how much pressure did you feel on that? And you clearly laid out your stall in the letter, but when the time arrived and they were in the studio, did you feel any anxiety?
with respect to the band and my relationship with the band, I felt absolutely no pressure. It was a completely normal session in the way that I described the session that I did yesterday and the day before. It was a session like that. The band came, they were well rehearsed. They played their songs live as a band. We did some overdubs, we mixed the record. They smoked cigars, everybody was happy. You know, like it was a completely normal session. In the back of my mind, I knew that there was going to be some administrative fallout to this because they didn't do it in the conventional way. The conventional way would have been for the record label and them to agree on a producer, for them to work in a sort of a lavish setting, for there to be periodic check-ins from the record label and management people to make sure that things were going according to their plan. You know, all of those conventions were not observed. The band basically went off on their own, made a record, and then brought it back to the record label and said, here's our record. And that represented a kind of a threat to the operating paradigm of the record business. And I understand why they were reticent to let them get away with it. I was not prepared for them sort of scapegoating me. And by them, I don't mean the band. I mean the administrative people in the record business kind of scapegoating me about, you know, that I was some kind of an obstacle, or that I was somehow trying to trash Nirvana for my own ends or whatever, like that sort of stuff. I didn't expect that. I didn't expect that framing, and I didn't expect those people to be that petty.
But it got that bad.
Yeah. I was being specifically named and singled out as a problem. It had professional repercussions, but I'm over all that stuff now. Like, I don't, sure. You know, that's water under the bridge. My relationship with Nirvana, the band, the people in the band has survived. I consider them friends to this day. We get along. I've worked in collaboration with them on other things since then. You know, I have no hard feelings whatsoever for the band Nirvana. They were in a really difficult spot, and I think they navigated it pretty artfully. I think they did a pretty amazing job of getting their original intention out into the stores without, without capitulating full force to the record label.
And weren't you involved in a remix, reproduction, reworking of the album? Was it the 20th anniversary?
Yeah. I want to say 2013. Is that when it was?
Yeah, I think it was. Yeah. Yeah.
Chris Novoselic contacted me and said, we want to do an alternate version of the album. And he explained that the inspiration for it was that he had bought a surround system for his house, and he a bunch of classic records that he was familiar with had been remixed for surround. So he was playing some of these surround records, and he noticed things on the records that he'd never noticed before, like little percussion elements or a backing vocal line or an alternate melodic choice or something like that. Because there had been an occasion to remix the record, some of these little details that he had never noticed before had been brought to the fore. And so he wanted an opportunity to do that with the In Utero album, to make a version of the record that made some different choices along the way. I know that he doesn't, and I certainly don't consider that version, the 2013 remix version, to be definitive. But the idea of it was that the record had had a long life and had been pretty deeply investigated by its listeners. So if a new version of it appeared that had some details changed, it might provide them additional insight into the record in the same way that he had gotten additional insight into some of his favorite records when he heard these sort of occasioned remixes of them. So that was the inspiration of it, was Chris Novoselic wanted to give people the experience of hearing something new in a record that they were familiar with. And in that setting, I think it was successful. I think that he did a great job of finding things on each song that could have been done differently. So let's try them differently, you know? And I think that was an interesting exercise. Concurrent with that, there was a reissue of the original version of the album done, and the reissue, the remaster reissue, was done with an eye toward the absolute pinnacle of quality. Like, let's do everything the best possible way to ensure that people get the best possible listening experience. So the master was done from the original stereo master tapes, not from production copies or whatever. It was done as an all analog transfer at Abbey Road through a discrete console. So the disc that was cut, the copper disc that was cut for the records, was a first generation edition of that, or transfer of that master tape. It was cut direct into metal, which is a process that was typically only done for classical records because it's more expensive and more cumbersome. So we cut it with the full DMM, that is the full direct metal mastering process. And the label said that they could do a double 12 inch 45 version, which would be even better sound quality than the LP version. So that remaster, the 2013 remaster of that album, is, in my opinion, definitive. That's the best possible transfer of the original master tapes. And I think it's the most faithful to what they heard in the studio.
Well, we've got all apologies here now, and it is your mix, but because we're being squelched through Zoom, I don't know if you'll be able to tell which version it is, but let's give it a listen anyway. Could you make out which that was?
I could tell it was Nirvana. I'm sorry. Not as close as I can get. I'm sorry.
Let's talk a bit about the studio that you're in at the moment then. Is it in use on a daily basis?
Yeah, this is Studio A. There are two studios here, Studio A and Studio B. Studio A is a slightly larger, slightly fancier studio. But they're both normal professional studios. Of a type that's kind of disappearing now, just because the institutional basis for studios is kind of disappearing. It used to be that bigger music production studios were tied to some other business. Either they were part of a production company that did production music for TV and jingles and radio or film scoring, or they were tied to a record label. So they were sort of the in-house studio for a record label. Or they were just used quite a lot by advertising and television and film work for the scoring and things like that. This is just a music studio that just makes records. So it's a rarity. And I think that the reason that we've survived when a lot of our other peer studios haven't survived is that we haven't relied on that institutional that institutional money has never really come here. Like, we've never gotten a lot of major label gigs. We've never gotten a lot of film scoring gigs or television production work. So when that work started to dry up, that was a big part of the support for other studios, and they suffered for it, whereas we never relied on that money, so it didn't really affect us. We've pretty much always just made records for either largely independent bands and bands on independent labels, but we've basically just made records, and that community, the community of musicians, is still quite strong.
I think we've got a little walkthrough of your studio, actually, because I'm just fascinated to see what it looks like. So we'll just cut to that for 90 seconds, if we may.
Electrical audio is a two-studio building in Chicago that was built by Steve Albini. He sort of set out to make this totally professional, top-notch facility that his friends could record at and independent bands could afford to come in and record a truly professional record. So there's Studio A, which is what the old studio manager used to call Color Oz, and Studio B, which is Black and White Oz. Studio B has like a more rustic appearance. The exposed existing walls have like a nice sound to them, like a really bright reverb in the big large room of Studio B that is great for acoustic instruments. And we keep all the microphones in this room just to have one location for everything. In here we have like a pretty sizable acoustically dead room, and you can fit like four or five dudes with super loud amplifiers in here. You get plenty of isolation between the two without using any like gobos or any other baffles. Everything in here has sort of proven its use to us, like in one way or another. Like, these are Neotech boards and they're transformerless and they're sort of known to be quiet and low distortion. Their idea is to be, you know, as transparent as possible. I love just like having the mics set up and pushing up the faders and people being like, oh yeah, that sounds great. Unless it's like a, you know, someone can't play their music and they're like, oh man, we should not be in the studio now. Yeah. As long as people want to make a good sounding recording, a good record, we'll probably be doing okay. We're not so expensive that that's out of reach for, I know that it's not out of reach for most bands, unless you're all homeless.
And so you booked pretty solidly.
Well, in normal times, yeah, pre-COVID, but the global pandemic has done a number on the music scene and everywhere. So things are quite a bit slower in the last year. Initially we shut down because we didn't want to have people here at risk of, you know, we didn't want to be the reason people congregated. The city shut down businesses, but we had been talking about shutting down regardless. And we were closed, you know, the doors locked, power off. The studio was basically non-functional for a few months. Then when businesses started reopening again, we reopened with fairly severe COVID protocols in place. And that allowed us to do some sessions. In between sessions, there's fairly rigorous sterilizing done, and all the materials and all the hardware and all the surfaces have to be disinfected. Like, after I finish this conversation with you, I'm gonna disinfect this entire area because haven't been wearing my mask. So all of this area needs to be disinfected now, all the furniture and surfaces, and the telephone, that sort of thing. So it's takes up a lot of time in between sessions. There's now like at least one day between significant sessions where we do disinfection protocols. And there are a lot of things that we can't do. Like, we can't have a group of people singing unmasked in a room together, for example. Trumpet players are problematic. Although a trumpet player just showed up the other day and he had a mask that was made for trumpet players. It had like a little split, like the Y front and underpants. But he could stick his trumpet into that on his mask. And then when he pulled the trumpet out, it snapped shut. I thought that was pretty clever.
That is ingenious. You've got this this great perspective on the let's call it the music industry, for want of a better description, as it was back in the 70s and now how it is in 2021, and so much has changed, it's barely recognizable.
Yeah.
Thinking about your ethical approach to the musicians keeping the money for their music, which is the best scenario?
Well, the large scale music business, that is the professional tier of the music business, is always going to operate for its own benefit. So the moment someone is in that realm, like pop star realm, you have to assume that there's an extraordinary inefficiency at work, where there are people siphoning her money away and keeping her from like being responsible about conduct, right? Beneath that tier, like that's we're talking like the pop star stratum.
Talk about, right? Major labels here, yeah?
Yeah. I mean, what used to be major label superstars But now, like, the labels are kind of irrelevant. Like, labels, who cares? Like, you know, there are people who are at that tier who've gotten there completely independently. You have people like Chance the Rapper, for example, who was releasing his music on YouTube, you know, straight out of high school. And he developed a following and he became a sensation without ever having to participate in the mainstream music business. You know, he's a fucking millionaire now and he's never had to sign anything. And that's incredible, right? So that's incredible. But once you get to that tier, that top tier of sort of ubiquitous pop star, there will be a train of assholes following you around trying to siphon money out of your existence. And that's no different now from the way it was in the 50s when you had, you know, a blues guitarist would sign a piece of paper and lose his songwriting royalties for life. You know, right. Like it's no different now than it was then in that regard. But there are avenues that you can exploit as an independent person to take control of pretty much every aspect of your career. Like if you wanted to tonight, you could go home and record something on your cell phone and post it up on YouTube. And tomorrow morning, everyone around the world could see it, right? That's incredible. That's absolutely incredible. Just the fact that you have access unfiltered to a worldwide audience by default, that is amazing, right? It does mean that there's an enormous glut of material out there and that it's hard to comb through it and find things that appeal to you. But that's where the social environment of you having friends and peers and people who you trust, and between you, you curate an experience of music where, you know, your friend gets animated about something and he sends you a link to it and you get to see that and you get excited about it and you send it to your friends and they say, oh yeah, that reminds me of this other thing. And in so doing, these networks of peers, of friends, have reimagined the notion of a music scene where it's now global. Like I'm in regular contact with people on text and email and, you know, all the other communications media around the world. And they're keeping me up to date with what's happening in their local music scenes that might be of interest to me. Here's a really interesting thing that it dawned on me a while ago that the whole time I was growing up in the 60s, the 70s, even the 80s, everybody heard the same music. Like the radio would play a short list of material. And if you were listening to the radio, you were hearing that, right? And then in the 80s, when MTV and videos became popular, like when there was a hit song, it would have a hit video and everyone would see that video. And now, if you just pick up anybody's phone and go to their music library and scroll through it, you're going to see the weirdest collection of shit. Like every person's musical experience now is intensely personal. Like it's specific things that they've found that animate them. And they've gone down their rabbit holes and they've like, you'll see some complete square that you think can't possibly be into cool music. And then you find out that he's completely obsessed with Senegalese guitar players or whatever, you know? Like, I think that is an amazing development in the internet era, is that you're no longer expected to have a common vernacular of music. Like, it's no longer the case that everybody knows what the top 10 is. I think that's amazing, right?
Sorry, go on.
So that's a great development. That's a fantastic development. On a professional tier, like how do you make money as a musician? Everybody is having to figure that out on their own. A big part of it are these sort of Patreon type things, subscription models. I have my reservations about that as a model. I feel like there's, you know, I feel like that's slightly perverse for me to expect other people to pay me to conduct my life what I was going to do anyway, you know. But I do like the sort of crowdfunding model where a band will raise money from their audience to do a project, and then that audience gets immediate access to it. I think that's kind of cool. And I also think that the way that bands are starting to self-organize their touring, rather than going through an agency that will then sell tickets at a markup through ticket brokers, they'll just post their dates online and you can buy tickets directly from them. I think that's a fantastic development. It's an order of magnitude more efficient. You know, it means that instead of the ticket prices constantly escalating because of these added on fees and surcharges, all of the money being spent on the ticket can go directly to the band. I think that's an amazing development. And I think we're going to see more and more of that, more of the sort of self-directed economy where the band and the audience are directly relating to each other rather than going through Amazon or Spotify or whatever.
We're seeing a situation here where particularly young artists, by and large, are posting material on TikTok, the social platform.
Yeah.
And they're becoming extremely successful. They're getting millions of views. And then, as you rightly suggested earlier, the major labels are then chasing them to sign them up. Do you think they should be cautious about that?
Well, think of it this way. If you got to a point of success on your own without their help, then why are they approaching you? They're approaching you because you're better at it than them. Like, they're trying to co-opt your success because you've beaten them, right? At this point, I struggle to find a rationale for anyone to sign to a record label. Like, what could a record label do for you that you or your friends can't already do on your own? Like, it used to be that manufacturing a record was an extremely expensive proposition. Like, you would have to invest, you know, tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars or pounds or whatever candy wrappers you guys use for money now. You would have to invest a lot of money to physically manufacture records, and you'd have to warehouse them, and you'd have to ship them places. And then if they didn't sell, you'd have to pay to ship them back. And then you'd have, you know, all these records piled up. That's not the case anymore. You know, physical manufactured records is still a viable thing, but it's a pretty niche market, and it's absolutely not something that you should base your career decisions on.
Bedroom pop's become a huge thing in 2021. It's been around for a while. This is people who, I think particularly during lockdown, one, two, three, whichever, have become quite adept at, well, understanding the software on their laptop and are doing some pretty good production jobs on it, actually.
I think that development is amazing. There's a, one of my favorite bands is a band called Sleaford Mods, and it's a two-piece.
From Nottingham.
They're from Nottingham, yeah.
Yeah.
And they, their music is extremely homemade. You know, it's basically just a laptop and some shouting, and that has inspired a whole like subculture of people who realize, yeah, you can just do this. I can just do this in Bandcamp, you know. And you have people like Billy Nomates, who's a friend of theirs and has collaborated with them, and she makes all of her music on Bandcamp. Like, not Bandcamp, but GarageBand. Sorry.
GarageBand, yeah.
I think that's absolutely inspirational. That's fucking fantastic. Like, you can use this free tool that you get just when you buy a laptop, you get this free, and you can make records and you can make music that is inspirational to other people, and you can end up building an entire career out of it. I think that's fucking fantastic, right? Now, granted, that's as a guy who owns a big studio, that I don't want to sit empty, right? Like, that's a cultural development that's going to be sort of bad for studios. But on a human level, just like the number of people that are going to get to realize their aspirations of making music, and are that they don't have to feel like their mode of expression is not valid because it was simple and cheap and homemade. Like, I think that's an amazing development. I think that's absolutely fantastic.
Have you, and have one, you one dub- thing, Sorry, go on.
Well, one thing that's happened during lockdown, because bands can't get together, like my band hasn't been in the same room for a year. Like we had a tour interrupted in March of last year. A year ago, we had a tour interrupted by the pandemic and we canceled our shows and we went home. We haven't been in the same room since, right? So we haven't been able to rehearse. We had an album that was essentially finished. We just needed a little more time in the studio and we're going to have another album out. That's on ice. Like everything is on ice. Like bands can't rehearse. They can't play shows. There's no touring. There's no festivals. There's no money coming in. Like the band structure is really difficult to navigate during the pandemic, right? Mm-hmm. But somebody sitting at home fucking around on his computer, dead easy, you know? And so that's the thing. Like the music that's come out in the last year or so has been some of the weirdest, most personal music. Like people just like pursuing these little things at home, like burrowing into very small ideas, that manageable things that they can do at home. I'm really curious how that's going to integrate when people can get back together, yeah, when music can be performed in public again. Like how does this very small scale thing that people have been doing for the last year, how does that inflate again into a general environment? You know, I think it's going to be interesting. And I know that like, it's a drag that people have to do things this way. And there's nothing good about the pandemic. I don't want to say that this is a silver lining, you know,
no, of course.
Millions of people are sick and dead. There's nothing good about it, but on top of that, I'm intrigued by these artistic and cultural developments that are happening because people are having to do everything at home, because people are going to having to do everything small scale with their own two hands. So I'm very curious to see how that like reinflates once the pandemic releases us.
Sure. Now you mentioned that your band can't put their album out just yet, but I think we should see a bit of shellac actually right now, if we can. When all this is over, when we can fly around the world and play gigs again, will you come to Nottingham and do a gig here?
Oh, too? Yeah, we've been there many times. I love the North. I think that whole like Nottingham, Leeds, Sheffield, Manchester, that whole corridor, like all the way up to Scotland is like some of the nicest bit of the UK.
Well, that's very kind of you to say so. The chat box is bursting with questions, Steve. So I'm going to hand you over to John, who's here, who's going to try and somehow get through all of these questions in half an hour.
We're going to have a good go. Steve, thank you so much for doing this.
My pleasure.
You've inspired so many really interesting conversations and really good questions, so I'm going to try and get through as many as I can. So what I've noticed about this talk that hasn't been apparent in some of the others is the level of geekism that people who admire your work have. So I'm going to dig into some quite deep projects and then maybe go a little bit broader, but let's go. Sandwiched between producing In Utero in 93 and building your own studio in 95, Shellac's At Acton Park, recorded in March 94, is still one of my favourite sounding records. Can you shed some light on your choice of recording spaces and techniques? Did the album for you represent a turning point in the way you approach record production? And finally, what did you learn with working with the late John Loder on this project?
So John Loder had been a kind of a mentor of mine when he had a relationship with Touch and Go Records and Discord Records, two famous punk labels in the U.S. Through his distribution company Southern, and he had been a recording engineer and had built a studio where a lot of my favorite UK punk records had been recorded, like the Crass Records and Rudimentary Peni and Bauhaus, quite a few records that to me were sonically ideal were recorded by him or at his studio. And when I finally got to meet him, you know, he was part of a circle of people who included a bunch of other really interesting people like Adrian Sherwood. I was sort of animated by that peer group, and I picked all their brains for knowledge and inspiration. And he had been a kind of a mentor to me when I was putting my home studio together. I had an 8-track home studio that eventually became a 24-track studio, which eventually became Electrical Audio, the studio you see behind me. And he had given me a lot of technical advice and had, you know, looked over circuit diagrams or diagrams of the studio and suggested some things that ended up being quite helpful. And seeing him operate in the studio, he had done a session with my band Big Black, and I'd gotten to see him in the studio, and I really admired his proficiency, the way he seemed to immediately know how to solve a problem when it came up. So I've always seen him as a kind of an ideal engineer, like very much rooting for the band, very much sympathetic to the band, but technically supremely confident and competent. He was kind of a mentor to me, and I kind of idolized his approach to working in the studio. So we did some recording with him at Southern Studios, this very small, very modest studio in, I'm trying to remember the neighborhood in London, Wood Green. So it's kind of a residential neighborhood, not really a big hub of music activity, not a lot of venues and stuff there. But so built into the garage behind his house was this very modest studio that he managed to get the absolute maximum out of. And so I was pleased to be able to do a session in that setting with him, with that band. And then from there, we went to France and recorded at a studio called Black Box, which had been built by another mentor of mine, another Englishman named Ian Burgess. Ian had lived in Chicago in the 70s and 80s, and he had been a kind of a cohort of the punk scene when I first got involved in the music scene in Chicago. And he recorded all of the local punk bands. And again, he represented a kind of an ideal to me in the way that he worked with the bands as an enthusiastic fan more than as a professional engineer. And he did a great job. The records that he made for those bands are really fantastic representations of those bands. The Naked Raygun album Throb Throb, for example, is a perfect encapsulation of that band at that time. He did a bunch of records for a band called The Digits, who were a straight up rock and roll band from downstate Illinois. And I really love the sound quality and the energy level of those recordings as well. So I admired him and I admired his approach. And just on a personal level, it was great to be working with him because I considered him a good friend. Both Ian and John are dead now, but both of those studios have survived. Black Box is now being run by his partner, Peter Dymel. And Peter, who's a genius engineer, technically trained at university in Berlin, but also a veteran of the underground music scene in Berlin. And he and Ian built this fantastic studio in an old French farmhouse. And it survives to this day. And it's one of my favorite places. I record there whenever I have a European band that can't travel to the US. I've, like, more times than not, I'll end up either at Abbey Road or at Black Box. And I'm equally excited about working at either place.
Brilliant. Thank you. What are your touchstones for you in terms of production, either past and present albums or projects, or past or present engineers or producers?
There are some records that were inspirational to me, and that when I first heard those records, they evoked a sensation of live performance, or of a feeling of communication between me and the band. I don't think there's a better record than the Stooges' Funhouse. When you're listening to that record, you really do feel like you're tuned into the mania that those guys had at that time for themselves and as a group of friends, and for the music that they wanted to make. And the sound quality of that record, I think, is perfect for that band. It's very straightforward, very simplistic recording, but it completely evokes the sensation of hearing that band in front of you. And I really, really admire that record for that. In terms of sound quality, there are quite a few records that I think are just flawless records. I think the AC/DC albums, Highway to Hell and Back in Black, from a sonic standpoint, are absolutely perfect. They're minimalist recordings. They're crystalline clear, but they're also intensely powerful recordings. I feel the same way about the Slint album, Spiderland. It's much different music, but the setting of that music is equally stark. But you do get a really like photographic presentation of that band. I quite, in a similar way, I admire there's a television album called Marquee Moon. It was their first album. Excellent. I think that's a perfect recording. So from a sonic standpoint, those are records that I admire and that I think represent sort of the pinnacle of a naturalistic presentation of music.
Thank you. Just expanded on Slint, we've got a few questions about Slint. One is, a big fan of both Slint albums, and like most of us, discovered them on the internet years after the band split. Do you think the industry switch from physical music releases to digital and streaming was instrumental to these albums increasing in popularity over the years? Or would Spiderland and Records Like It have been endured anyway due to the quality of the music?
Well, very specifically, Spiderland started its progression from unknown release to, Touchstone masterpiece. It started that progression almost immediately. Like, it was released at the end of the 80s. And when it was released, it sold a few thousand copies, kind of a perfunctorily released record of a band that had just broken up. Then a year later, it sold double that amount. And the year after that, it sold double that amount. And the year after that, it sold double that amount. So it was clear that that record was building a following just through word of mouth and from people hearing it at their friends' places or whatever. So specifically the Slint record, I think, was discovered gradually piecemeal by people over time. The internet has certainly accelerated that for a new audience. There are quite a few people whose careers were completely revitalized by their music being available on the internet. There's a great film about the band Death, a pre-punk band from Detroit. The film is called A Band Called Death, and their music was basically unavailable until somebody heard a dub of it on an online resource, tracked the band down, reissued their music, and then they got to have a complete career where they were able to tour and sell records and, you know, have the experience of being in a successful band that was denied to them when their music was originally made. The singer Rodriguez, who had a similar, there's another documentary film about his resurgence as well. Like, his music survived in a niche audience until it was more widely disseminated on the internet, and that completely revitalized his career. So there are a lot of people for whom that's true, where their music has disseminated over the internet and has like created a career that wouldn't have existed otherwise. So yeah, I think in general, you can credit quite a few artists can credit the internet for revitalizing their careers.
Amazing, thank you. I mean, we've had so many questions on what was it like to work with XYZ. So if I was sort of to gather those up, do you think the most successful moments that you've captured in the studio, the people involved have had something, a certain magic, any traits, or is it just you are capturing what's there and you don't think and move on?
Well, I think it's a mistake to think of music as being good or bad, or to think of some kinds of expression and art as being like noble and brilliant. Every kind of music has its own soul. Like, there is music that means nothing to me, but when the people who are tuned into it hear it, it animates them to a degree that is unfathomable to me, right? So I think it's a mistake to look for genius in that way. I think the job of the engineer is to present things in a way that the person expressing them wants them heard. Because then, even if I don't get it, even if I miss the point, if I'm doing my job correctly, if that music hits someone who's sensitized to it, then that band, that artist and that audience will get to have the relationship that they deserve. So I think it's a matter of sort of professional diligence for me, that I treat everyone that I work with in a way that respects what they're trying to do. I'm intensely suspicious of this idea that someone can spot a star. Oh, that person's going to be a star, you know, and then, you know, that's just another way of sort of stealing the applause from that person. Like, oh, they were just sitting there in a coffee shop until I made that record for them. And then I, you know, like that whole thing, I think that's really creepy and I don't want to participate in that. I think the kids playing on buckets at an intersection, you know, busking for dollars in the subway or whatever, like that music and those people deserve as much respect and attention as someone who studied at a conservatory and has been working on his opus for 10 years. Like, I feel like every kind of music has some innate charm to it, some innate essence that the people who are doing it understand. I may not get it. I may not understand it at all. But if I do my job correctly, then someone else can hear it down the line who is sensitized to it, who does get it, and those two will get to have a relationship. And that's sort of how I see my role.
Brilliant answer. Onto some geeky studio time now. Desert Island studio gear, Steve. Let's assume this desert island has great solar panels. If you could take two mics, two preamps, two compressors, and a pair of monitors, what would they be?
I only need one compressor, really. Monitors, I really like the B&W 805 size, the ones that are on this mixing desk here. I don't know if you can see that.
Yeah, we can. Thank you.
I think that size is great. It has reasonable bass response. For a midfield monitor, they're somewhat portable, so I could take them with me if I needed to. They're really, really bulletproof. Like, you can solo the bass drum and crank it, and you see the speaker leaping out of the box, and it doesn't, you know, and it's really, really hard to damage them. I can listen to them at any volume. Like, some speakers sound okay, quiet, but yeah, and if you crank them up, then you can start to really get the picture of the sound, but then you end up fatiguing your ears. I'm perfectly comfortable listening to those at any volume. As far as large field monitors are concerned, the best I've ever heard are probably the large size B&W monitors that Abbey Road's mastering studios used to have. I want to say they're 801 size. And I really loved working on those speakers. That I felt like I could hear in detail in that room better than I could anywhere else in the mastering suite at Abbey Road. Microphones. I'd probably bring... There's a ribbon microphone, the STC 4038. It's been a favorite microphone of mine for many years. I use it on a lot of different things. I use it principally as a drum overhead. I use it on electric guitar cabinets. It's a fantastic acoustic instrument mic, you know, for cello, violin, acoustic guitar. That would be one. A second microphone. Wow, two microphones. Okay. There's a David Josephson microphone that uses a Gefell nickel capsule called the 617 SET. It's an omnidirectional measurement or sort of calibration style microphone, similar to a B&K microphone, or the DPA is what they're called now, similar to a DPA microphone. I think the bass response is better, and I find myself preferring it over any of those other sort of clinical omnidirectional microphones. that's my go-to microphone for over a piano at the moment. It sounds great on all acoustic instruments. I use it as an area microphone for ambient recording. Yeah, really terrific microphone. If I could have a pair of 4038s and a pair of those, I could probably record almost anything.
Brilliant.
Then
thank you.
For mic preamps, I don't want to sound like I'm a homer here, but there's a mic preamp that Greg Norman, who works at Electrical Audio, made. The EQ pre-Q, I think is what he's calling it. It's a extremely wide bandwidth, very flat, very high headroom, very high gain mic preamp that has a tilt EQ for bass and treble on it. So you can tilt the high end up or tilt the low end up. And that goes in click stop increments so that it's resettable. I've done comparisons with that mic preamp with literally everything else we have in the studio. All, you know, the Neves, the John Hardys, the GMLs, the API stuff, everything that we've got, I've compared that mic preamp to, and it's rare that I find myself preferring anything else over that mic preamp.
Wow.
There's another mic preamp that I quite like, the front end of the old Ampex 351 tape machine. We converted a bunch of those to standalone mic preamps. And they're fantastic. I use those all the time as well. They have a slight high frequency rise, so they're very good for vocalists. They add a tiny bit of clarity to the top end. But there's a great sounding circuit. It's a very simple gain cell with a transformer on either end. And I think it's a really great sounding mic preamp. So the Ampex 351 as modified by Greg Norman, and then the Greg Norman microphone preamp, I think those would be my go-to two mic preamps. And as a compressor, I mean, I don't use compressors that much. I'm going to say something simple like a DBX 160 would be fine.
Thank you. And then sort of the flip side, where you, if you're coming into the industry, you're short on money, what would be your key bits of gear that the students in the audience might want to buy or weigh up?
I've been very surprised by, you can get a set of microphones from the Russian company Oktava. Now, Oktava is an old company. They've been around for a very long time. They're a Soviet era company, but they sell a transistor microphone now called the MK012. And we have a set of those that comes with different capsules and they're not expensive, you know, a couple hundred bucks for the set. And I think they're a really good sounding, really versatile set. Like I've heard anecdotally that the quality control isn't that great for that microphone. And that, you know, from one to the next, the sound quality can vary quite a lot. I don't know about that. I've only, the two that I've got, I think sound great. And I've used them at other places and I thought they sounded great and were quite versatile. Dirt cheap. There's another dirt cheap microphone. There's an Audio-Technica microphone called the Pro 37. I think their retail is like $100. Really nice, crisp condenser microphone. Good for percussion and acoustic instruments. It can handle some signal level, so a small guitar amplifier would be okay. But you know, anything louder than that, it might overload. But for a cheap, for a general purpose condenser microphone, I think they're great. There are some not terribly expensive microphones by Audio Engineering Associates, AEA. They make some modern ribbon microphones, which are more ruggedly designed than old ribbon microphones. And so they're less fragile and less prone to damage. And some of them have internal head amplifiers. Like there's one called the N22, I think there's one called the N8, and they have an internal head amplifier that uses phantom power from the console. And that effectively removes the loading characteristics that were sometimes a bugaboo with ribbon microphones, where the ribbon would be loaded by the console input and wouldn't sound good. These mics with the internal head amplifier kind of defeat that. Royer makes a similar microphone. I think it's called the 221 that has a head amplifier in it. But I tend to find myself preferring the AEA versions. And that's that would be a good way for people to experiment with ribbon microphones without having to worry about them being so as fragile as the vintage pieces are, and certainly nowhere near as expensive.
Brilliant. Thank you. Time is almost upon us, so I'm going to hand you back over to Dean. Thank you.
Steve, it's been an absolutely amazing session. Thank you so much. The stories, the inspiration, your thoughts on the direction of the music industry, and your altruism as well as somebody who's a mover and shaker in the music industry, inspiration to all of us, as well as the technical advice there. So I say thank you very much indeed for your time. It's been very much appreciated, and I do look forward to the day when we can meet face to face and hopefully see you in Nottingham, at Rock City maybe.
One of my favorite venues is the... Oh, now I'm drawing a blank on it. It's a social club.
The Bodega.
No,
used to be the Heavenly Social.
No, I'm drawing a blank. I apologize. Now I feel okay. I've been out of the game for a year. Give me a break.
Look, it's great to see you. Thank you so much. It's been an absolute treat. I know everyone's really appreciated it as well. So thank you for your time. Stay safe, and we look forward to seeing you at some stage in the future. Thank you.
Steve, if you could just stay on the call for a couple of minutes while we empty the room, that'd be great.
Sure.
Thanks, students. Thanks, Tex, for an amazing week. Enjoy.